Hello, and welcome to Dan's Vehicle Dynamics Corner. My name's Danny Nolan, and I'm the Director of ChassisSim Technologies. And today, we're going to be taking a little bit of a different tack from the usual ChassisSim tutorials. And I'm going to be introducing you to basically what I call my Vehicle Dynamics Corner. Basically, the Vehicle Dynamics Corner is basically an opportunity for us to sit down and have a little chat about what are some things you really should know about with regards to race car vehicle dynamics. It also is a great opportunity for me to introduce you to the Data and Dynamics Race Car Engineering seminars, Data and Dynamics Race Car Engineering Explained. We run these through the year. We're having one in Sydney in August, and we're having one in Indianapolis at the end of the year. And it's a great opportunity for us to sit down, have a great chat about the things that really make a race car work, and the things that really, really count to get the most out of your race car. Now, what we're going to talk about in this corner is basically some suspension geometry, myths and reality. Now, I'm not going to cover basically the whole of the suspension geometry section of the Data and Dynamics seminar, but what I'm trying to do here is to stir you up a little bit, give you some things to think about, and really just give you a taster of what you're going to be in store for the Data and Dynamics seminar. So, let's get started. Now, when we think about suspension geometry, we all think about kinematics, and we start to think about instant centers, etc., etc. Now, without a doubt, the most fundamental concept you're going to be dealing with suspension geometry is the concept of an instant sensor. And as we can see in our little diagram here, it really is just a glorified case of basically connecting the dots. As we can see here, we've got a wheel center, we've got our wheel center line, we've got our double wishbones, and we've got an instant center. Now, basically what we can do is basically we can construct a little beam that goes from the instant center to the wheel. That's what we mean by the instant center. So what's tended to happen in the, so what we can do is that this is just doesn't apply laterally, but it applies longitudinally as well. And as you can see, we see the same thing for the McPherson strut. We also see the same thing longitudinally for a V8 supercar live axle rear end. Rough rules of thumb: the shorter the instant center, greater camber recovery, but it maximizes the strut. But the longer the instant center, minimum camber change in pitch, but it sacrifices roll performance. So, let's now have a look. Now, let's have a look at the kinematic roll center. Now, we've all been taught that with the kinematic roll center, basically what we do is we construct our instant sensors for the left and the right hand side, and it's basically like a glorified version of let's draw and connect the dots. And we wind up with a roll center with both a lateral and longitudinal location. And we've all been taught that's where the roll center is, this is where our forces all go through, etc., etc. And ever since then, people in both the race car vehicle dynamics community and the road car vehicle dynamics community have been absolutely obsessed with basically looking at both vertical and horizontal roll center translation. But here's the question I'm going to stir you up with. Is this what really goes on? Let's have a look at the relationship between kinematic and force-based roll centers. Now, this is really interesting because when I first started to study race car vehicle dynamics after graduating as an aeronautical engineer, what you're about to see is the first proof I ever did. And so basically what we've got here is that we've got our tire with an applied lateral force. We've got a center of gravity, and just to keep the math simple, I basically put the lower wishbone parallel and the upper wishbone basically at an angle, as you can see. Now, what I really want you guys to do is I want you to go through and basically do this proof. Now, if you go to the Data and Dynamics website, you can actually download an article where I actually outline the nuts and bolts of this a little bit more. But this really illustrates, though, and when you do the numbers, this really illustrates that the thing that is in fact rolling the car is in fact force application points. If I could put my finger, ladies and gentlemen, about where things really, really, really went wrong with suspension geometry and where it got completely out of whack, was the fact that we all got tied up in basically where this kinematic roll center is, etc., etc. We all got obsessed with basically where vertical and horizontal roll locations were going. But in reality, as we can see in this little diagram here, the thing that is in fact rolling the car is in fact basically your force application point. This is basically where the forces are this is basically, ladies and gentlemen, where the forces are transmitted. Forget about putting forces at the kinematic roll center. All we do is we basically take the instant center, as we can see, as we take the instant center here, as you can see, we look at where the center of gravity is, we construct the line from the force application point to the instant center, we see where it intersects below the center of, below the center of gravity point, and that is the force vector that is rolling our car. This, guys, is just so, so key, and I must admit, I will never forget, and I have Bill Mitchell to thank for this. When I first did this proof, and I'll just go back to it, about 15 years ago, and because it came out to be exactly the same roll center location as the kinematic roll center in a symmetric situation, I figured, oh, okay, this is basically where it's got to be, and I spent 10 years basically chasing my own tail without fully realizing the implications of this. This was an absolute, and when I really read that Bill Mitchell article, it was an absolute light bulb turning moment. This force application points is the true mechanism of what's rolling the car. And guess what? Now, a lot of people figure, okay, that's all good for lateral. Now, what do we do for the, just let me backtrack a little bit, what do we do about the fact when the A arms aren't parallel? Well, that's actually really, really, really simple. All we do, basically, is that we basically take where the wheel center line is, as we can see in this document. So, and you can actually prove that by doing a free body diagram of the upper and lower surfaces. And as you can see, basically, we just find those planes, basically on the wheel center line where we hit the chassis, that's where the force application that's where the force application point is. And really, I started to see this when I started to implement this in ChassisSim. It would have been now about 4 years ago. I always had relatively good correlation in roll. When I started to do with that, that good correlation turned into outstanding correlation on formulas that are now so numerous, on formulas that I've now lost count over. Now, that's all well and good for the lateral case. What about the longitudinal case? Guess what? Exactly the same case applies. And really, I must admit, when we look at anti-dive and anti-squat, anti-dive and anti-squat has got to be, if there is one area of race car vehicle dynamics and vehicle dynamics that has been made an absolute mess of, it's been this concept. Because quite frankly, it actually isn't that hard. And like with the concept of the force-based roll center, the force-based pitch center really allows you to really nail down where basically those forces are applied. So if we define that, we basically define the pitch center as basically the force that is rolling the car, and basically the pitch center is effectively the moment arm between where the force is applied and where the center of gravity is. So how do we determine this? It's actually really, really simple. In this case, what we've got is we've idealized it as a V8 supercar axle rear, as a V8 supercar axle rear end, and I've just done this for illustration purposes. What we do is we basically find where the instant center is. We basically join the line from the bottom of the tire to where that instant center is, and the pitch center is basically that line directly underneath the center of gravity. And in this case, I've simply got the instant center and the pitch center aligning. Now, that covers the case when the torque is being applied at the axle, so we're basically braking or accelerating for a live axle. When the torque is being applied at the chassis, like for the case of inboard brakes, or when we've got an independent rear suspension, we go through exactly the same process, except in this case, we drop we determine the pitch center in the usual way, then we drop it by a rolling basically the rolling tire radius. That's all there is to it. This, ladies and gentlemen, is the fundamental mechanisms of what drives the car. And to illustrate that, let's have a look at this. Basically, all your suspension geometry, your suspension geometry interactions can be pictured by this very, very, very simple diagram. We basically have pitch sensors, FY1, FY2, FX1, FX3, FX2, and FX4. That's the fundamental mechanism of what is rolling the car. Now, in the data and dynamics seminar that we'll do in Sydney in August, we'll be looking at doing in Indianapolis at the end of the year, we're going to show you that in great detail and show you why that is so powerful. So look, go to the ChassisSim website and check it out. Go to the data and dynamics at www.dataanddynamics.com. Register for the seminar, and I guarantee you, we're going to show you some really interesting things that you can do with that.